You're listening to BBC World Service and this is Music Life. I'm musician, producer, DJ and composer Nitin Sawhney, joined by musician and songwriter Norah Jones, composer, producer and sitar player Anoushka Shankar, and composer and sarod player Soumik Datta.
Staying creative during lockdown, I mean, I know Anoushka as well does, but I have a 4 and a 6-year-old, so it's been a little trickier, but I've tried really hard to carve out a little bit of time each week to just play, and there have been song ideas, but I'm not, you know, making a symphony or anything. I'm mostly making dinner and arguing about the TV and making crafts.
This year I've been thinking a lot about this because I know this is the 250th anniversary of Beethoven, and Beethoven in the last years of his life created his greatest work, and yet he'd become totally deaf by that time. And it was interesting that he actually copied down scriptures, Hindu scriptures, in 1816 when he was 46. And I find that really interesting because from that time on, he created such incredible work. And the listening that I think he did was internal. And he found inspiration from so many different things outside of actual sound. And yet he was able to translate that into music, which I find so fascinating. I mean, do you feel that there's an internal voice that you listen to as much as your music?
It's not just music that inspires my music. I mean, obviously it's life and emotion and lived experiences, but I find it incredible how much all forms of art can inspire music. And it's hard to define how, but like for me, watching dance is one of the most inspiring things. Like there's just something about an incredible human body, you know, the top level artists, you know, whether it's our friend Akram Khan or Sidi Larbi Charkawi, these people dancing just takes me to this place that reminds me of what's possible, you know, and I couldn't mathematically define how that inspires me then in my music, but I know there's a direct link between watching them dance and then me being able to play anything beautiful at all.
Well, that makes a lot of sense, particularly with Akram and Soumik. You worked a lot with Akram Khan as well. Mm. I mean, how do you find that when you're actually performing with him? Do you feel that really feeds into the way in which you play?
Absolutely. I mean, performing with him, there's this. You're definitely in the presence of an energy that is probably even beyond him. But actually, what I find interesting is when you work with dancers in the rehearsal rooms and in the studios, it's that mirror, you know, that mirror. And for ages, it was just like, oh my God, that's so vain to have for dancers to have a mirror in front of them. But actually, it's the same as the art of listening that musicians need, that because that's their feedback, that and they don't get a chance to do that on stage. They can only do that off stage, you know, gain that feedback and tune their bodies to do exactly that same thing.
That's interesting. I mean, in a way though, you know, when you're playing music with Akram, you know, you're acting like a mirror to what he's doing, you know, musically. So it's kind of
right.
And it's incredible to see that. I mean, Norah, are there other art forms that actually inspire you in the way that you play and in the way you write?
Absolutely. Do you find your pottery inspiring?
Oh, like,
does
you're
that
so
inspire
sweet.
You in your music? She's an amazing potter.
Well, I wouldn't say amazing. I'm a weird
potter. My favorite mug is by you.
Oh, thank you. And my masks are very creepy.
Your masks are creepy, but your bowls are amazing.
I haven't had a chance to do that in about a year. Not really, but I do find that my emotions come out in what I'm making. Like, remember all those weird masks I make?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I remember one that just looked like Satan.
Yes.
Yeah, I was going through a time when I made that one, and I didn't intend on making it, but I just, like, I made this crazy satanic, like, devil head. It was crazy with, like, a big tongue. It was really scary. And I remember my friend in pottery class was like, what is going on with you? I was like, I don't know. It just came out of me, you know. So sometimes it just happens, you know.
Wow.
Do you feel like you tap into a flow in that similar way?
Or yeah.
I just wonder if you get that experience.
I do. And sometimes I can't at all because I'm a lot less skilled as a potter than I am as a musician. But yeah, you tap into something, whatever you're doing, you know.
That's a really important point as well, because when we talk about flow, I think sometimes people can get frustrated that they're not reaching that flow.
Yeah.
At the beginning of a journey with something, you know.
Exactly.
And I think it's really important to remember that the flow comes from the ease that has come from the practice. And that the more we practice in a very kind of practical way, we can then have more and more of that flow.
It's like learning how to talk when you're mm-hmm. a child, and then all of a sudden being able to have an easy conversation with somebody versus being a two-year-old.
I find actually it's quite interesting. It's quite interesting when you ask lots of questions when you're doing something, you know, like you know, things that you kind of think of, or you might imagine, oh, it'd be good to try and do this and see what happens, rather than necessarily feeling like I'm trying to learn something. I'll always just think, I wonder what would happen, or I wonder where this will lead if mm-hmm. I try this thing. So you enjoy the journey rather than being goal orientated. I mean, do you how much do you feel actually Soumik, how much do you feel you're goal orientated in your work, or do you feel that it's actually all about the process and the flow?
It's the world you live in. It forces you to like have goals and meet them and deadlines and things like that. And so the pressure is there. And actually, you know, what you said just now, Anoushka, about sort of skill, it is really difficult to, having spent so much of your life working on a skill, to then actually think, I need to put this away somehow and find something greater than it and beyond it and more powerful and simpler. And it's a weird thing to say, that your pursuit for virtuosity leads you to then pursue simplicity. Just came up with that.
Oh, wow. Is that something you
pretty good. You should write that down. Yeah.
Is that something you've discovered under lockdown, or something you've been chasing?
I definitely feel I've discovered it over lockdown. I mean, I didn't play for weeks, maybe even months at a time during lockdown, and I was feeling like, okay, am I going to find that at the end of this year I suddenly can't play, or like various things are not in my hand?
No,
those fears were there, but I didn't go back to the instrument. And then when I did, what I found was that there was a softness that I was trying to achieve before, but I could never find, and it was just there. It was like I opened the box one day and just took it out, and it was just there. It was sort of weird.
Do you think that that's part of the journey from being an instrumentalist to being a composer? You know, is it about maybe kind of simplifying what you know, all this stuff that you've learned and all the stuff you practiced into, and disseminating it into something that you can communicate in a very different way?
Yeah, and Anoushka, you'll know this, like, you know, coming from, you know, the sort of the core of Indian classical music, there is a lot of pressure, you know, playing these sort of solo lead instruments, and being good at them does come with this weight of being technically skilled at them, and yeah, I think over time there's a need to let go of that ferocity and maybe search for a bit more, like a bit more soul, a bit more softness. Maybe that's what it is.
I mean, did you feel that, Norah, with jazz harmony? You know, you've studied jazz harmony and you know your jazz harmony backwards, but the thing is to actually then turn that into songs that, you know, that people can relate to and empathize with. I mean, is that an interesting journey?
It's interesting what you're saying, and I've seen this also with a lot of different kinds of musicians, but I can see in Indian classical how that would be a thing. Coming from a totally different place, I've also seen it with jazz musicians who learn everything. They transcribe John Coltrane and, you know, they can play it backwards and forwards, but I don't want to listen to them because they play too many notes and there's no melody. And I tried to chase that in college, and then I actually dropped out of school because I didn't practice enough and I couldn't face 4 years of classical juries, and I love that music, you know, but that's not where my heart was. And I almost feel like my musical journey has been sort of dictated by my limitations in that way. You know, I gravitate towards ballads and simple things, partly because I love them and partly because I don't have the chops to play crazy, you know, virtuosity. Not really though, but not in the way that you guys have come up, and I'm okay with that, but it's been a real interesting thing for me. I think I realized early on that I wanted to chase simple things, but when I moved to New York and I was playing piano and singing and playing in the jazz clubs and going to different places to see these great musicians, I didn't have a piano, so I got a guitar, and that's when I started writing music. But I had no technique whatsoever. I mean, I was very rudimentary on the guitar, but that's when I started writing songs. I find that I write my best songs when it's sort of in my head and it's not from my fingers playing familiar chords that are sort of a just natural go-to, but they're not driven by the emotion or the spirit, the transcendence of music that we're all sort of chasing.
You're listening to BBC World Service and this is Music Life. I'm musician, producer, DJ and composer Nitin Sawhney, joined by musician and songwriter Norah Jones, composer, producer and sitar player Anoushka Shankar, and composer and sarod player Soumik Datta. Anoushka, with your background as a sitarist, I mean, becoming a songwriter and also composer, you know, for film and also recently for the television series Suitable Boy, and you know, I mean, with all of that, has that been, you know, with your background as a sitarist, making that transition into writing lyrics and singing yourself and actually expressing yourself in quite different ways?
There's so much to unpack here, isn't there? I mean, I have found with like every passing year I seem to play less and less, and there's more and more space between my notes. And I think that has come from the confidence to be able to let that space happen. You know, there's a kind of almost fear of letting that space happen. I don't know why, but that's always been present for me. It's like I always need to say the next thing or the next thing. And now to just start to feel like I'm comfortable sitting back and allowing that whole note to vibrate, you know, it just feels like a whole different thing now. I mean, you know me, I love to play fast.
And you're so good at it.
I love it.
But you reach that transcendence playing fast. You definitely
Thank you. And I think it has its place. And I think when it's a part of the story you're telling, then it reaches the same kind of heights and depths as like a really soulful slow thing can. You know, it tells a different part of the story that needs to be told. I just think that when that starts to dominate, like it very often can with instrumentalists, because we think through the instrument. That's where, for me, the balance starts to tip, and I feel like I'm no longer telling the story of whatever that song is about. And I think to stay connected to that, you know, takes a trust in the music, as opposed to in the instrument, if that makes sense.
You know, now you've kind of taken this step into, you know, with Love Letters, you've taken a step into a whole new way of thinking about expressing yourself, you know, and it's very heartfelt, and other people I really think have empathized with the way in which you've expressed yourself. Do you think that that's going to guide your future in terms of how you approach albums?
I'm sure. I mean, well, every album guides the next album, you know, it's all part of the living process, I guess. But yeah, Love Letters, you know, it's the first time I've had a collection of what you could call love songs, I guess. Not that they're all romantic, but they're all informed by love. And so my approach was so different. It was just about like speaking through the instrument. And definitely it was the simplest I've ever played. And it's the kind of thing that maybe 10 years ago I would never have thought I would do. But that was the way to let the feeling really show, I guess. Yeah, and I think obviously like working with vocals, which, you know, obviously Nora's a singer, but like I know you work with singers as well, Soumik, and you do as well, Nitin. I think it's hard to find that balance sometimes. Like if it's my song and I'm an instrumentalist, but the song has lyrics, the vocalist kind of has to take that center place, because that's where the ear goes and that's the most primal music making there is, right? So I have to sit around the human voice in a certain way that on an instrumental piece is different, I guess. So that really changes things too.
And Soumik, I mean, working with voices do you feel that you're doing that more over time, or are you going deeper into your instrument over time with your own work?
I feel like I'm going deeper into the instrument while also like wanting to reach really far away from it at the same time, which is a weird thing. But just in terms of, you know, what you were saying, Anoushka, like, you know, the placement of your instrument in a track has so much, I mean, I've really struggled with that over the years, because, you know, the world that we come from is that, you know, sort of the sitar, the sarod, these are lead solo instruments that sit in the middle, bang in the middle, not a little bit to the left or the right.
And no one is moving us out of there.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, there's this, like, you know, you're at the top of the hierarchy, you lead the stage. And I've always struggled with that, because actually that's not who I am. Like, I'm much more of an infantryman. I'm not, I don't want to be the captain of the ship. You know, I want to hang out with the soldiers and make jokes.
I love this army analogy for music.
Because of that, then experimenting with where does the sarod go? Like, can it actually fit a little bit to the left or the right? And can it mix with the hang or the harp or something while we put something else in the middle? You know, that has been a really liberating exploration to break that hierarchy of sounds as we know it.
I can relate to that because recently I've been playing more piano trio, just my piano, bass and drums and singing. And anytime somebody tries to mix it, sometimes you do shows and other people mix something and I'm trying to approve it. Mm. They put my piano way on top because it's me and I'm the artist. And I'm like, no, that sounds horrible. My piano is meant to sit with the band because it's playing as part of the band, you know? So it's really different the way you present it. But it always like freaks me out because I'm like, oh my God, turn the piano down.
Do you find it difficult to give control to other people in that respect? You know, sometimes,
funny. My sister's laughing her butt off.
I mean, you know, to actually have created something with a specific sound, a specific feeling and so on in your head, and then to have other people, you know, shaping that in whatever way or sonically kind of interfering sometimes with that. I mean, how does that feel to you?
I've had the ability to control things for a long time since my first record was so successful. And I've gone in and out of like being an extra control freak and really just wanting to not control it. But you do have to see your project through to the end because somebody can ruin it and they might be thinking they're doing the right thing, but it's not what you intended. So I always have to see things through and it's something that annoys me about myself because I don't want to have to always do it, but it's important. But then when you find somebody who you work with, who gets you and you find a partnership like that, when you can let go a little and trust someone, that is the best kind of collaboration.
Mm. And, and Soumik, you know, you've worked very closely with Bernard Schimpelsberger, you know, in terms of that whole kind of bouncing something back and forth between you. I mean, do you find at times that can be quite difficult, or is it always flowing and is it always easy? I mean, how do you find that process?
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly always flowing. That doesn't mean it's not difficult at times. But I think that's needed as well. I think that the disagreements are as important as the moments of harmony. I remember, you know, there were so many moments in the studio where I just didn't want to go in a certain direction that he pushed me to go. And actually, I'm so glad that he did, because we came out of it with a direction for the song that I would have never taken. By taking it, it sort of allowed me to explore something, a different part of myself.
Anoushka, I mean, you're kind of somebody who's done, you know, you've collaborated with so many people, but obviously with your own father being your guru, you know, without his presence in your life, I mean, do you find that you've had to, in a way, become your own guru more over time?
Oh, I can't answer that one.
Really?
Answer the other question.
Yeah, can I go back
yeah,
first?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah,
sorry. Yeah. Delete.
I'd like you to answer that one though, at some point.
Delete.
Yeah,
no, it is interesting. I think collaboration is so interesting because, like, for me, it depends on the nature of the project, and that will inform my approach to it. So, for example, I'm very different when I'm a guest on someone else's album than when they're a guest on my album, or when it's a collaboration between two of us. You know, that totally changes the approach. So when I'm guesting on someone else's album, I'm a lot more flexible about how the piece turns out because it's about their vision and I'm contributing it, you know, to it as much as they want. At most, I might say, hey, can I check the mix? Because people who don't know the sitar have a tendency to really cut the life and soul out of it when they mix it. And I want to be able to just make sure it sounds good. But I don't kind of have final say. I don't try and have that. Whereas if it's my project, you know, like Norah, I really want to see it through to the end, you know, every layer. Yeah. And there's a lot of value to, you know, inviting in people's creativity, but ultimately I'm steering it, right? And I think like proper collaboration, I've done a lot less, but like Breathing Underwater was an album I did with Kersh Kale, and that was probably the only thing that was an actual duet, you know, like it was our album. And that was the one that was really interesting because it was our album. So those moments where we had different visions, which is maybe what you're talking about with Bernard Soumik, it's about both of you. And so we would have to argue it through to the end if we had different opinions, and one had to convince the other of the merit of an idea in order for it to stand, and that's quite tricky. I don't know if I could be like in a proper band in that way long term.
Well, that's interesting because I'm in two different bands that are more even kind of, and boy, the email chains go back and forth like crazy. But I love it because it's different for me. Mm-hmm. And back to what I was saying before, I was talking about with my own project. I think probably one of the best things for me in the last 20 years as a musician has been doing true collaborations with people, whether it's I'm guesting on their albums, like you were saying, or being pushed outside of my comfort mm-hmm. zones for different reasons. More recently, I've been trying to collaborate on purpose with people, like writing from scratch. The album I did with Danger Mouse, it was different than anything mm-hmm. I would have ever thought to do because of that collaboration. So I'm not a control freak when it comes to those things. I am totally open, and that is the best thing about it. And it pushes you into different spaces. And that's amazing.
I remember being really surprised when I heard you with Q-Tip. I mean, that for me was like, I hadn't heard your voice in that kind of context. And it was like quite a revelation. Yeah. I suddenly thought, wow, this is not, you know, the Norah Jones that I'm kind of used to hearing. Yeah. I mean,
Well, that one was interesting, actually, because I remember that one. I was still a little bit more green at coming in on other people's thing, and I was totally out of my element. I remember saying to him, this is too high for me. Maybe I'll sing it an octave lower. And he was like, no, sing it high. Sounds great. What's the problem, you know? And I was like, but I am not comfortable. And then he pushed me to do it, and I loved it. And I think that was a moment where I switched, and I was like, oh, I can use this other range in my voice, and it has a totally different effect. You know, like I learned something about myself, and that's the best part.
And Soumik, you know, are there people that you really look forward to collaborating with in the future?
Yeah, I think we should make a single or something.
This should be just a group session.
This whole thing with the backbeat behind it. Perfect. Let's do that.
Yeah, give me that backbeat.
Thanks so much to my guests Norah Jones, Anoushka Shankar and Soumik Datta, and thanks for listening. I'm Nitin Sawhney. Head to the website for more Music Life shows, bbcworldservice.com/musiclife. Before we go, are there any projects out now or coming up that you're working on that you'd like to tell people about? Albums, collaborations, where people can find your music? Norah?
I just released an album called Pick Me Up Off the Floor that I'm really proud
of. And it's an amazing album.
You can find me on Thursdays for my live streams, hopefully.
Very cool.
Hopefully I'll see you there.
Anoushka?
I just released the vinyl of Love Letters in August, which you can get, and a couple of collaborations in October. Soundwalk Collective will be releasing an album along with Patti Smith, and I got to play on some of that music, so got to be with Patti Smith, which is amazing.
Yeah,
and cool. And there's a compilation album called Goodnight Songs for Rebel Girls, done by the Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls people, and I've done a cover of Bjork's Yoga, which is one of my favorite songs ever.
Amazing.
And I sang on it.
That sounds great. Yeah. Oh, really? Wow, you sung with Bjork?
No, I just covered her. If that isn't a stupid thing to do, I don't know what is. But
awesome.
Soumik, what about you?
I released an audio series, a five-part audio series, which was basically my lockdown project. It was for Culture and Quarantine. It's called Sounds of Silence, and it's still on BBC Sounds, so you can catch it there.
When I make albums, I'm always working with people, but the Immigrants album that I've got coming out is you know, next year. It's been a whole different approach through lockdown, just working with lots of artists in their own isolated experiences and situations. And so it's kind of, I think it's taken on a really different mood to anything I expected it to. It's kind of grown its own kind of flavor and its own feeling that probably wouldn't have happened if I'd been just touring and doing the things that I normally do. So it has a different flavor, I guess.
This has been really fun, you guys. Thank you.
Nice one. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Let's start a band.
Thanks,
Nitin.
Thanks, Nitin. Bye. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.